Tonight in Boston, Kirill Kaprizov, number 7 in the National Hockey League in scoring, leads the Minnesota Wild, along with Matt Boldy, who grew up coming to Beanpot games here at TD Garden, went to Boston College, now makes his NHL debut tonight in Boston as the Wild are here in Beantown to take on the Bruins. It is hockey night on ESPN, a grown man's league, but excited to watch these men play a kid's game. Are set to drop the puck as we welcome you to the Verizon pregame. It is hockey night on ESPN. The Wild and Bruins here in Boston. Bob Wischusen here with Brian Boucher. AJ Molesko down at the red line. She'll join us in just a moment. Coach Cal might want to give that pregame speech in the Wild locker room, right? They need to get fired up. They need a win. It's been a while since they got one.
Yeah, this Minnesota Wild team, let's face it, this is not the same team that we saw a month and a half ago. They were embarrassed at the Winter Classic. They've had some injuries. There's no doubt they've got some illness. Their schedule has been erratic. But to me, those are all excuses. Right now, this team needs a spark. So how do you get a spark? Sometimes it comes from within the room. Sometimes it comes from making a drastic move by calling up some prized possessions in the minors. And for Bill Guerin and his club, it's about bringing up Marco Rossi, a guy that has scored and produced points at every level, and Matt Boldy, a guy that can score and played very well in his 2 years at Boston College. They're going to get an opportunity not only to just take a shift, they're going to get an opportunity to play power play minutes, have an impact offensively, and hopefully provide a spark for this Minnesota Wild team.
And AJ, the top players for Boston, they have produced, but they're starting to get more production from the guys on lines 2 and 3 as well.
Well, and that was the big thing that this team needed coming into that COVID pause in December. They needed secondary scoring. The three big guns, the perfection line as they're known, they're no secret. And you can look at their numbers, but David Pastrnak, he didn't score a goal in the calendar month of December. So Bruce Cassidy, we talked to him this morning, and he said it's always about the next game. How do we generate that secondary scoring? It's amazing. You look at it, 3 games in 4 days to start 2022. They had 14 goals, all 5-on-5, and they had 13 different scorers, not all from the top line. So it certainly worked what Bruce Cassidy is trying to do. I will say, I won't be surprised if that line gets back together at some point.
One of the great traditions of the National Hockey League. You make your debut, you take the ice first, and do that rookie lap all by yourselves. The rookies will make their debut for the Wild when we come back to Boston. Come. Welcome to ESPN Hockey Night, presented by Expedia. Bob Wischusen, Brian Boucher, AJ Molesko just about set to drop the puck between the Bruins and the Wild. Let's take a look at our Honda starting goalies. Boosh. Kaapo Kakkonen gets the start for the Wild.
Yeah, for the Minnesota Wild, Kaapo Kakkonen, his last start was December 11th against the Los Angeles Kings. A loss in LA where he made 35 saves. And at the other end of the ice, Jeremy Swayman, 23-year-old, who just continues to put up good numbers for the Boston Bruins. He will get the start here tonight against Minnesota.
For the Bruins, it's their fourth game in 6 nights after 2 weeks of postponements and the Christmas break. And for the Minnesota Wild, this is only their second game in 17 days. They played the Winter Classic. The last time they actually experienced a win, they beat San Jose on December 9th. It's been a long time since they were in their room afterwards celebrating a victory.
And it's very difficult, Bob, to get out of rhythm and not play a steady stream of games. I mean, coaches like practice, but this schedule has been awfully erratic for the Minnesota Wild. Certainly not easy for them to handle.
And at the top of the screen, we are bringing you the starting lineups brought to you by Taco Bell.
It's interesting, too. You look at the Wild. They were the last team to present a COVID-positive case in the entire National Hockey League, but their schedule was still just as disrupted. You look at Dean Evason there, just signed a new contract, multi-year contract with the Minnesota Wild. He's done a great job with this team since taking over from Bruce Boudreau in February of 2020.
Yeah, what I like, AJ, what he's got his team playing is they play with grit. They play hard. They get in on the forecheck. They have an identity to their club.
Number six, Boston, minor penalty tripping.
And the first power play of the game will go to the Wilds. Only 32 seconds in as Mike Riley heads to the box.
We got Matt Boldy's first shift, power play.
And that's a good thing, right? I mean, I like the idea that for Dean Evason, as we get a look at the penalty right here off the faceoff, a good call by the official, that is a trip. But what I like that, you know, you get these young kids called up. It's not just about taking a shift. You're going to put them in situations where they're typically used to playing, give them an opportunity to succeed.
Well, there's a little change up there. Now we got Marco Rossi out here on the left point starting in the second power play unit, starting them off.
Well, maybe AJ, he earns this trip out with the second power play unit. He drew the penalty.
Yeah, and you know, it's in some ways, maybe there's some, you just look at the way that there's a little confusion there coming on Matt Boldy, not sure if he was going to get out there and get his shift. Of course, these guys, probably better to get out there 5-on-5. Get your legs.
Goligoski through center. Got it across the line. There is Rossi. Plays it back up top to Kaprizov. Right side. There's a shot that whistles wide. As missing the net. As the puck comes all the way back out to the neutral zone. Kulikov couldn't hit the net. Now Goligoski will cycle back in Minnesota ice. And Rossi sends it hard around. Matt Zuccarello off his skates. Marchand taps it to the boards. And Marchand able to get it out to the neutral zone.
One thing to keep an eye on with this top unit that we were talking about is Marco Rossi is such a puck distributor, and that's what Dean Evason told us. He loves to give the puck up, and you got Kaprizov and these other dynamic scorers out there on that unit.
Kevin Fiala to the red line. Across the line, there is the rookie Matt Boldy. Plays it back up top to Dumba, gets a return. They play catch. Now it's Freddie Gaudreau. His wrister banks off the end boards. Behind the net is Boldy. Cycles one to the corner. 48 seconds to go in the power play for Minnesota, but Boston able to send it all the way down.
And in contrast, Boldy more of a shooter. So you got Rossi the playmaker, Boldy the shooter. You got to expect nerves on both these guys here early in this hockey game. They just want to get a bump, get a play at the net, get into this hockey game.
Fiala hooks a pass cross ice. Thrown towards the net with Fiala right on the doorstep as he almost connected with Boldy. Boldy in the corner. Freddie Gaudreau gets it back out to the right point to Dumba. Dumba will hold. Sets up Boldy. Backhands a pass onto the tape of Foligno out in front. Freddie Gaudreau taps it to Boldy. There's a drive from Dumba, and it just goes off the outside of the net. Trying to stuff one's home. Short side is Gaudreau, and that is covered up by Jeremy Swayman. Big time pressure on the power play by Minnesota with 6 seconds to go in the man advantage.
Oh, I talked about nerves, maybe not. So for Matt Boldy, look at this. Backhand sauce across the ice to Marcus Foligno, which creates some havoc at the net. I mean, that is a terrific feat by the youngster Matt Boldy. And eventually there was a couple of opportunities at the net for the Wild power play. Matt Boldy, who grew up not far from here in Millis, Massachusetts, played his college hockey at Boston College. Good first shift on the power play.
Bruins clear, so that will kill off the man advantage. I think he said 9 family members here on tickets. A bunch of his BC teammates are in a suite as well. And you wondered, and probably a fair question, who's the credit card bill going to?
Yeah, I think he's playing for free tonight if you've got 9 tickets on the hook.
Charlie Coyle banks one off the end boards to Grizzlick, and a stretch pass to center missed Nick Foligno as the Foligno brothers squaring off again tonight. Nico Sturm gains the zone. Nico Sturm moves in, puts it on the forehand, turned aside by Swayman. And Grizzly controls the rebound, gave it away. Kaprizov to the goal line, pivots in the corner, sends one up top. John Merrill, wrist shot, chest save made by Swayman. Loose between the circles, it's still there. And finally cleared all the way down by Brandon Carlo. And this will be icing called on the Bruins. Our first opportunity tonight, check in with the studio and say hi to Arda.
Thank you very much, Bob. Let's give you an update from the Devils taking on the Columbus Blue Jackets at Prudential Center. It'll be Tomáš Tatar scoring his second, a goal in two straight games. The Devils have won 3 of 4, Bob.
Yeah, that loss to the Bruins in a wild game a couple of nights ago. Hartman on the draw with Foligno, and Foligno wins it. And Carlo sends it out to the Boston line. Foligno there to feather it deep, and the Bruins will change. John Merrill deliberately forward. Off the stick of Goligoski. It is sent deep. Wound around the boards. Past Merrill and all the way down. And it looks like this will be yet another icing for Boston.
We're going to look at Bruce Cassidy, who's got his team on a three-game winning streak. And AJ mentioned in the open the splitting of the top line and trying to create some balance. Certainly seems to have found it in the last couple of games. That's a positive, isn't it, AJ?
Yeah, you know, and it's interesting when we asked him, do you expect to put them back together? And he said, it's just about the next game. We're trying to generate that secondary scoring. And they did work. You look at the trying to get Pasta, you got him and Hall together and maybe some speed, and they could create some offense off the rush.
What would you need to see, to both of you? And Boosh, you first, maybe. What would you need to see to say, all right, it has accomplished its goal, now it's time to put Pasternak back up with Marchand and Bergeron?
Well, you need to make sure that Taylor Hall finds his confidence and finds his game. But I feel like for the Boston Bruins, the hole for that team is at the second center. They're missing David Krejci. They've got Eric Halla playing the center position. They're trying to find a way to fill that hole. And until they do, I think there's going to be juggling all the way around for Bruce Cassidy and his hockey club. But if Taylor Hall can somehow find his game, start to generate offense on his own, maybe it'd be a much different story.
Bergeron across the line, moves in with room, wrist shot. And it hit the under part of the crossbar with a penalty call. Somehow that got past Kakkonen but did not go in the net. He got just enough. It will be a Boston power play.
Well, Boston pushing back a little bit. Minnesota generated a little bit of momentum off that power play. And here's Boston coming up with that first top line with Craig Smith there. And I like the way that they drive the middle. There's some east-west play there at the top of the zone that creates that space with a shot. And then Bergeron ends up having an open shot. Somehow Kakkonen missed that with his glove.
I wonder if there's going to be two penalties on this play.
Minnesota number 22, wow. 2 minutes for slashing. Minnesota number 24, 2 minutes for hooking.
Yeah, the play by Dumba on that last replay to save a goal, a penalty that he had to take. But there was already a delayed penalty on Kevin Fiala.
Fiala tried to skate away. Thought Dumba was taking the penalty for him. That's what you're talking about, Boosh, right there, that hook.
Oh, yeah.
I mean, that's an empty net right there for Pasternak. You're right, that's what we call a good penalty.
What a keep by Pasternak at the point. Or rather, Grizzlick to start the 5-on-3. Charlie Coyle in the right wing corner. Here is Grizzlick. Plays it in the corner now to Marchand. Cross ice, Pasternak missed the net. Back onto the stick of Marchand. Marchand moves in closer, tried to stuff one in front, and it rolls in on net, loose in the blue paint. They dig for it, finally a whistle.
Well, the power play for the Boston Bruins is something that I think has been a source of concern for the Bruins. And for Bruce Cassidy, he made mention about David Pasternak and the fact that his shots have been missing too often and too much. And that there on the one-timer on the 5-on-3 missed. A good opportunity off a good feed, missed opportunity for the Bruins.
Well, it'll be interesting to see, too, how they do without Charlie McAvoy, who's out with injury day-to-day right now. Grizzlick taking that spot up top. It's a lefty, not a righty. Maybe a different dish over to Pasternak.
Marchand to Grizzlick. Back to Marchand. One touch to Bergeron, but it's taken right from his skates and out to neutral ice. That is great hands on the penalty kill by Goudreau. The 5-on-3 continues for Boston for another minute. Marchand, right wing faceoff dot, holds there. Side of the net, oh, just missed on the stuff by Coyle. Quickly to the puck, is Kulikov. And down him, two men, they get it out. Two on one. A scoring opportunity as Swayman kicks away Goudreau's shot. Back the other way, a two on one. Now for the Bruins. It is Marchand. His pass blocked by John Merrill. Marchand to the puck, top of the left wing circle. Between the circles now. Down along the goal line to Coyle. Between the circles. And a diving swipe. And it is out to the neutral zone. Terrific penalty killing. Down two men for the Minnesota Wild as Goudreau was everywhere. And now Patrice Bergeron takes a penalty. Well, as he goes two for tripping.
Yeah, some missed opportunities for Bruce Cassidy and his club on the power play. Brad Marchand with a couple of beautiful feeds on this power play. Maybe too much heat on that one for Charlie Coyle. There was a miss by Pastrnak earlier, and then eventually the Wild did a terrific job getting out of the zone, creating a two-on-one shorthanded. Bergeron with the trip, and that'll end the 5-on-3 for the Bruins.
Well, a minute and a half of 5-on-3. That just always feels like a must-score situation to me from a momentum perspective, and certainly would give the Minnesota Wild momentum the other way.
So the Bruins, a 4-on-3 for another 22 seconds, and then Dumba and Fiala will both hop out of the penalty box, and it will be a power play for Minnesota. Riley gets a return. One-time shot. Missed the far post. Gathered in by Hala. Sets up Riley. Back to Hala. Back to Riley. That shot by Hall. Score! Taylor Hall, a one-time drive with 2 seconds left in the 4-on-3, and the Bruins take the early lead.
Well, we talked about Taylor Hall and trying to get him going. One area of the game where you can get your confidence and get your mojo is on the power play, and that's exactly what happens. 4-on-3, a little bit more ice. Good one-touch passing. This puck goes through the five hole of Kokkonen because it goes off of Jonas Brodin in front. Looks like a harmless shot, but goes off the leg, and that sneaked through the legs of Kokkonen. Hall's third power play goal of the season.
You know, I think having four guys out there almost took some pressure off the Bruins. They moved it crisper, cleaner, and then they forced the Minnesota Wild, who did do a good job in their adjustment, but they forced them to get out of position and opened up those lanes eventually for Taylor Hall to find the daylight.
Tough break for Kokkonen, too. I mean, it really is not a difficult save under normal circumstances, but when it goes off of your defenseman, it's funny how pucks just seem to find their way through open holes, and Taylor Hall is able to get that one past the Minnesota Wild net miner for this early score.
Well, as a defenseman, too, you either got to block the shot or get out of the way. That's the worst feeling.
Well, now it's Minnesota on the power play, down by a goal for another minute and 10 seconds. And from the corner, it is fired the length of the ice by Derek Forbert. So Taylor Hall, his seventh. Riley and Hala, the assists. Through center, dropping one back is Goligoski. Kaprizov fires it hard around. Zuccarello crashing into the right wing corner. Kaprizov tries to dig the puck free behind the net. 2-on-3, they battle, and the Bruins win the battle, at least for the moment. Kaprizov sweeps it to the blue paint, but Curtis Lazar was there, and he skates it free. Still 33 seconds to go in the man advantage for Minnesota, and Lazar will kill some time as he gets it all the way down behind the Wild net. Dug free by Alex Goligoski. Tried to feather one center circle. That was broken up by Trent Frederick. Frederick first to the puck.
Marco
in
Rossi.
The trapezoid.
Sorry, Bob. Marco Rossi just showed some great defensive prowess on a big back check on full length of the ice.
And even before that, AJ, he had a good read. Came down from the point, tried to keep the play alive below the goal line. And then, as you mentioned, the 200-foot back check. Unfortunately, he was out of gas for the rest of his power play shift.
And the power play now over. We are back at five aside. So a 4-on-3 goal scored by the Bruins as Taylor Hall gives them the lead as we approach the midway point of the first period. Right in front of the benches, Foligno backhands one to Fiala, taking off his stick. Ping pong through the neutral zone. And now it's Nick Foligno, forcing one deep behind the net, hoping for Craig Smith. Ends up back to Charlie Coyle, right wing half boards. Coyle to the goal line, hard angle shot, whistles all the way around. Coyle And Smith in on the forecheck looking for the puck, and now it is feathered all the way out to the neutral zone where it's poked by Nico Sturm. But Grizzlick able to wall off Connor Dewar and do a nice pivot pirouette and spring the Bruins back the other way. Kulikov, though, controls for Minnesota. Feathered in by Kulikov. Grizzlick first to the puck into the skates of Taylor Hall. He's freight trains. A Wild win the puck. Turning it over, though, was the rookie Marco Rossi. Ren Pitlick has it center circle. He'll wait for some help and finds Kaprizov. Drives one. Love save made by Swayman. And he will hold on midway through the first with the Bruins on top 1-0.
Well, the Boston Bruins have had no trouble scoring goals here lately, and they get one here on the power play. Taylor Hall with his seventh of the season. You give the Bruins a 1-0 lead here early in the first.
Next week, the Flyers and Bruins meet in Boston.
And he's got the hat trick!
And on January 20th, the Avalanche take on the Kings.
He scores!
All for hockey, Thursday nights on ESPN.
Let's check the standings, brought to you by Crypto.com. And in the Central Division out west, Minnesota in the middle of the pack, but Bush, they have not won in their last five.
No, they haven't, and Nashville is a surprise for me in the Central. In Colorado, you just knew they weren't going to stay down forever. So it's a tough division. The Wild have hit a bump in the road. They're looking to straighten it out, though.
Hand pass called here, and another check-in with Arta Okal.
Thank you very much, Bob. We'll take you to Columbus and New Jersey now. Tomas Tatar made it 1-0 for Jersey. Columbus would tie it up thanks to the effort here from Max Domi. It is tied at 1. Back to you, Bob.
Catch with the tank, uses his skate to keep that in, goes back.
The fourth game in 6 nights for the Bees. They've won 3 in a row, 6-2-2 in their last 10. And again, playing against a Minnesota team that's gone a month without tasting victory, but they haven't played many games. The Winter Classic is the only other game in the last 2.5 weeks that Minnesota's played. Bergeron comes across the line. That's a shoulder save made by Kakinen off his wrist shot. Kaprizov the other way. Puts on the brakes at the blue line, but just barely drags the puck offside. ESPN Hockey Night is brought to you by Verizon, the official 5G network of the NHL.
There's been some good jump in this game, hasn't there? I mean, the Wild obviously wanting to avenge the loss at the Winter Classic, but they had a good start. Obviously, they give up the power play goal to the Bruins in this period, but I think both teams have had pretty good jump here to start this hockey game. Good energy from both sides.
Yeah, it's interesting. You talk about the Wild. They haven't played in so long with all the COVID positives. Stressing 11 forwards with Duhaime testing positive just this morning, actually. Pulled off of the morning skate here at the TD Garden. Unavailable because of COVID protocol. And Dean Evason said, you know what, I think our forwards are fresh enough. We're going to go with 11.
There's a giveaway. Foligno ridden to the boards behind the net by Connor Clifton. Swayman just about turned one over, and now Dumba pinching in. Looks to center. It caroms back up top. Brodin keeps it onside. Throws one towards the net into the right wing corner. Foligno will wind it around. Along the half boards, waiting for it was Brodin. It's in the blue paint, chopping at it, side of the net, Rossi. And now it's feathered back up the wall, and the Bruins break out. Frederick has it. Banks one, hoping for Anton Bleed, beaten to the puck by Dumba. And the Bruins will peel off and make a change.
Right, good stuff from the youngster Rossi there, getting inside with that opportunity. He's not the biggest of guys, but you can see he has the courage to go to the hard areas. Good opportunity there.
And Jonas Brodin making his return from COVID, just as a couple of players are lost to it. But Dean Evason talked about what he thinks Jonas Brodin's return means to this team, their style of play, and how he fits right into it as Carlo has it right point. Along the half boards, wheeling and dealing is Foligno. Carlo flips one to the shelf in the far corner. Oscar Steen lost an edge.
Well, and Dean Evason mentioned about Brodin. The issue that he feels that the Wild have had mostly is that they've not been able to get out of their own zone cleanly. And Brodin's one of those guys that can move it well. He's got good hands, but he's also got great feet. And he can skate. He can skate it out of trouble. So that's something that they're looking forward to having in the lineup once again.
You would look at Brodin, and Bill Guerin talks about how underrated he is. I mean, just signed a big contract with these guys. He said he's so critical to their success, the way that he breaks that puck out, as you're talking about, Bush.
This will be icing on Minnesota with 7:22 to go in the opening period.
Well, we'll take a look at the power play goal for Taylor Hall, and why this happens is because of quick puck movement. When you move it quick, you get the defenders out of position. Look at the space that's there for Taylor Hall, a fortuitous bounce or deflection off of Brodin. But when you move it quick, you don't dust it off, you create space like that. Good job by Boston on the power play.
Faceoff one for the sixth consecutive time by Minnesota. And Rem Pitlick banks one deep. Connor Duer racing after it, pulls up along the half boards. Wheel around wrist shot, went right through the crease. Ben from the near side, his shot was blocked. Pasternak back the other way. Stick handles across the line, looking for a toe drag. And he was walled off nicely by Kulikov. Grizzly pinching in, puts it into the trapezoid, moved around to the far side. Loose side of the net. Kept alive by Howell at the point. Ben looks to move it. Comes together with Taylor Hall. Walled off very nicely by Jordy Ben. And the puck out center circle.
There's some of the trouble you were talking about, Bush, with the Wild having trouble breaking the puck out of their zone and resorting to just flipping it up out into the neutral zone and get those tired bodies off the ice.
Yeah, it takes away from your offense, doesn't it? I mean, you get hemmed in, you don't make tape-to-tape passes. It certainly can stifle the way you want to play. And Minnesota's a very good offensive team, but it starts coming out of their own zone. If they can do it cleanly, they give their forwards a chance.
Clifton plays one, left point, gets a return. Drives one! And that may have gotten blocked before it got through to Kokkonen.
Boston's very aggressive on their defense pinch, which also makes their forecheck so effective. Leaves a little bit of open space up the middle of the zone, though.
But they're about to take a penalty. Marchand bowled a man over, and he will go. So out of the box, or out of the net, as Zuccarello puts one side of the net, and that is missed by Kaprizov, as it's now a 6-on-5. Fiala wraps one back to Kaprizov at the left point. Delayed penalty call on Boston. As Zuccarello leads one for Kirill Kaprizov. Holds along the half boards. Gets double teamed. Boston can't control the puck, so the 6-on-5 continues for Minnesota. Fiala plays it straight away. Goligoski. Now it's Fiala along the goal line. Kaprizov. He gets behind the net. And it is finally now touched by the Bruins as Trent Frederick able to stop play. A power play for the Wild when we return.
63 Boston minor penalty holding. Boston 25 minor penalty interference.
We've got two penalties called against Boston, so it will be a 5-on-3 for Minnesota when we return. ESPN Hockey Night is presented by Zuccarello has it. Goes behind the net, gets a return from Kaprizov. Kaprizov tries to stuff one to the side of Swayman, and the puck hopped, and now it is cleared all the way down by Forbert.
Now, I like the idea by Minnesota working from behind the net, and those can be difficult to defend, so keep an eye on that.
Interesting, Rossi is absent from this top unit for this 5-on-3.
Fiala across the line, Zuccarello works the left point. Goes brink wide, shot, score! Oh, there is the quick trigger from Kirill the Thrill. A power play goal for the Wild, and they deadlock the game at one.
Well, just like in the 4-on-3, there's a lot of ice. Well, 5-on-3, there's a lot of ice as well, and this is just a terrific pass. Cross seam by Zuccarello, hangs onto it, finds that seam. I mean, defending-wise, you have to know that Kaprizov is on that weak side, and Charlie Coyle not able to get his stick in the lane. Zuccarello saw it all the way, and Kaprizov with a beautiful finish.
If you look at Zuccarello, too, he does sort of a look away. It's very deceptive the way he's a great distributor and really good with his vision, but he doesn't give away, doesn't play his whole hand.
But for Coyle up top, I mean, he shouldn't know what Zuccarello's doing as far as the deception. I mean, he really has to come down and get that stick in the lane. And if Zuccarello wants to go to his partner up top at the blue line, that's fine. You can recover, but you got to know where the dangerous shooter is. And Coyle not able to locate it, and the Wild make him pay.
Struck me that 5-on-3, a little different than the way the Boston Bruins played theirs. They were the Wild was much more spread out, which certainly makes it harder for the defenders. That's just so much ice for them to cover.
Still on the power play, Minnesota for another 55 seconds, but Coyle easily able to send center circle to Holla, and he will dump it in. The Bruins change all four penalty killers. 45 seconds to go in the man advantage. Zuccarello lost it center circle to Frederick. Here's the rookie Matt Boldy, the BC kid, who drops one off, making his NHL debut in a building he grew up going to beanpot games in.
Bob, you sound excited when you say BC.
Fiala with a wrister. You sense that?
I do. The tone went up.
Dumba drives one. That was blocked by Lazar. Controlled by Boldy. Along the half boards, he plays it back up top. Here is Fiala. There's another wrister. Another save by Swayman. Into the blue paint it goes. Goudreau poking at a loose puck that is covered up by Jeremy Swayman with 6 seconds to go in the Minnesota power play.
Well, good stuff here from the Wild on the power play. You get the other unit out. The top unit was able to score, and some more good chances by the Wild as they try to create the lead. But Jeremy Swayman does a fantastic job of locating those shots and covering up the rebound.
A Minnesota goal, by the way. Kaprizov on the power play at 15:25 from Zuccarello and Fiala. The 14th of the season for Kaprizov. And now Bergeron gets chased. So Marchand moves in to square off on this draw with Nico Sturm. And now Sturm is shown the door. And the crowd likes that. Connor Duehr wins the draw. Back to Brodin. He'll drive one. Score! Not sure if it was deflected in front, but that was a rocket from Jonas Brodin. And the Wild take the lead.
Oh, some confusion at the faceoff. A couple guys get tossed out of the faceoff. Eventually, Duehr is able to win it cleanly, and then the traffic in front by Duehr. Faceoff win, and I think Sturm may get a deflection on it in front right there. Hard to tell, but the traffic by Duehr was why Swayman wasn't able to recognize it. The faceoff win, the traffic, good stuff by Minnesota.
Well, you look at the way the Boston Bruins, if you get thrown out, no matter what happens, no matter what position you're in, you've got to know what your job is. If you win the faceoff, you got to know what your job is if you lose the faceoff. In that situation, there was some confusion with Bergeron taking that left wing spot and not fighting his way out quick enough.
We'll get the official scoring, but Booch, I think you're exactly right. I think Nico Sturm just barely redirected that puck past Swayman to give the Wild the one-goal lead. There's Brodin along the half boards, pitching it behind, hoping for Sturm. Out into the neutral zone. Taylor Hall was taken down, looking for a penalty call. And now we may get some retribution for that hit by Dumba. Across the line, Goudreau holds up along the half boards and turned it over. Pasternak to Hall, and right back to Pasternak across the line. Is Rister kicked out by Kakinen. The rebound put behind the net. After it is Jordy Benn. Being helped out by Marcus Foligno. Now Benn moves the puck, but gets walled by Pasternak. Fiala able to free it up for Minnesota. Benn through center. He'll fire one in. Swayman blockers it aside. And now we've got a whistle with 2:10 to go in the opening period, and the Wild on top 2-1. ESPN Hockey Night is brought to you by Dunkin'. Smoother than freshly groomed ice, Dunkin' Cold Brew will keep you running all season long. Because where there's hockey, there's Dunkin'. America runs on Dunkin'. ESPN Plus Tuesday night between the Red Wings and Sharks, and then a Wednesday doubleheader on TNT. Canadiens Bruins right here at TD Garden, and Maple Leafs Coyotes in Arizona. That game on Wednesday night between the Canadiens and the Bruins here at TD Garden was supposed to be played in Canada, in Montreal, but the league right now, until they're allowing fans back in the Canadian buildings, either postponing games, or that's technically a Canadiens home game that's been relocated to Boston, because the next night will be here for Bruins Flyers.
Yeah, good creative rejuggling by the National Hockey League. And if you ask the players, they'd much rather play in front of fans than an empty building. So good job by the NHL to do that.
Lazar with speed to the backhand. Stops by Kakinen. Back up to the left point. Thrown in by Carlo. Side of the net. And it ends up in the glove of Kakinen with traffic in the blue paint.
Well, Anton Gleed jumped out here on this shift, and he was out to start something.
Zuccarello and Frederick, no matter how much the linesmen are trying to keep Frederick away from Zuccarello, he's not having it.
Well, I wonder if Zuccarello, I mean, if Frederick's going to get one, yeah, for ripping the helmet off of Zuccarello, you can't do it. Referee Corey Savret right there. It's one thing to throw a couple of punches, a couple of jabs. When you rip the helmet off intentionally, that will get called every single time, even if the play is after a whistle. So it looks like Minnesota will get a power play out of this.
Well, you got Kaprizov and Bleed already in the box, sitting down. Skated over together. It actually looked awfully cordial based on what happened when the puck was in play. Patrice Bergeron exits the bench to go over, and as does Marcus Foligno.
Now, you appreciate the intensity by Trent Frederick. You know, you love the willingness to want to get in there and get your nose dirty, but see, he grabs right there. He grabs with the visor. And Zuccarello reminds official Corey Savret that's a penalty. He says, yep, you're right. And Frederick will sit in the box, and it'll be another power play here for the Minnesota Wild.
Mentioned it before, but Anton Bleed, 81 for right there on the left, on the right rather. He comes out and he just was heavy, looking for a hit, looking to start something. He obviously succeeded with his line mate Trent Frederick. Curtis Lazar out there with them. Bleed in for Thomas Noshik, who's out tonight.
So with the extra two being assessed for ripping the helmet off for Trent Frederick, it is a power play after all is said and done for Minnesota. The Bruins able to win the draw, though, and fire it all the way down. So Bleed and Kaprizov both go 2 minutes for roughing. And Frederick, two for unsportsmanlike conduct for pulling off the helmet via the visor. Dumba with a drive and a blocker save made by Swayman. And the rebound chopped out to the neutral zone. Here's a break for Marchand. Shorthanded, moves in. Poke checked away by Kakinen just in time. A little tic-tac-toe play back across the Boston line for Minnesota. Foligno rink wide. Sets up Fiala. Fiala right back. And Foligno missed the redirect up into the netting and out of play.
Well, there's an opportunity for Minnesota because Brad Marchand ended up losing his stick right there, trying to pick it up, and there's a quick shot. But because Marchand is slow to get his stick and get back, he gets this opportunity not as cleanly as he's like, because Kakinen wasn't quite sure what to do. Bush as a goalie, that's got to be one of the toughest decisions if you go out or not.
Yeah, and I wonder if Marchand was confused as well, because I didn't think he was skating as fast as he typically would. I think he was expecting Kakinen to come out and play that puck, and because of that, a little indecision and a missed opportunity. Yeah, those are tough plays for a goalie. You got to make the decision quick and hope you make the right one.
Hartman fires it around. Forbert tried to keep it moving. Kept straight away by Goligoski. His shot gloved down by Swayman. 47 seconds to go in the first period.
It's time to put the win in winter at Dunkin'. Introducing Winter Blend Coffee, a vibrant new medium roast that's full-bodied and smooth with notes of ginger snap. Take on the day with Dunkin'. Enjoy a medium hot or iced Winter Blend Coffee for $2. America runs on Dunkin'.
Bob Wischusen, Brian Boucher, AJ Molesko.
Interesting lineup out here. You got Addison, who's dressed as a seventh defenseman, but he's playing up on this power play for Dean Evason's Minnesota Wild.
Yeah, with Kaprizov in the box, that opens up an opportunity for Addison to get on the power play. Good opportunity for him here.
He's got the puck. Down to Zuccarello. Zuccarello put it right between the circles. Controlled by Goligoski. He gets a return. Rink wide. It is controlled now and banked back up top to Goligoski. Goligoski holds. Wrist shot. Knuckleballs in. Stopped by Swayman. Right back to Goligoski. He will hold. Another wrister. Again, knuckleballs. Goligoski down to his knees to keep the play onside at the point, but loses the battle to Curtis Lazar. Down to the last 11 seconds and now 9 to go in the opening period.
Goligoski got a little cute there on the blue line.
Hartman across the line, looking for a return. The rebound just rolls wide of the post as a soft wrister was put on net by the rookie Marco Rossi, and it almost fooled Swayman as we end the period with Minnesota on top by a goal.
A couple of good opportunities for Ryan Hartman in this power play. A redirect in front, that chance there at the end. Good start for Minnesota here in this first period.
Let's take a look at our SAP Coaching Insights app. The Minnesota Wilds, they've been pretty good when leading after the first period this season, as they are nearly perfect. We'll see if the Bruins can pull this one out from behind as the first period is in the books. Our score at the end of one, a Wild 2, and the Bruins 1. The Lexus First Intermission Report is coming.
You could be one of the greats.
We are back on ESPN Night, ESPN Hockey Night, presented by Expedia. Just about set for the start of the second period. Three goals scored in the first, all three on the power play. Special teams, a big deal in the first 20 minutes. Bob Wischusen with Brian Boucher. AJ Molesko is ringside. We'll talk to her in a moment. You talked about the little things and how much Minnesota needed to concentrate on those.
Yeah, it was important, right? And I thought the power plays for both sides were very good in that first period. But yeah, the little things are important when you're in a hockey game, and sometimes it's about winning faceoffs at critical times, particularly on the power play. You get a faceoff in the offensive zone, you have the opportunity to start with possession. And here Bergeron, who is not taking a faceoff because he got kicked out, a pick by Nico Sturm, didn't allow Bergeron to get out. That left time and space for Brodin. The tip by Sturm was able to go in. But AJ, it's not too often you see two guys get tossed out of a faceoff in the same draw.
No, it isn't, and it's a clean win. You mentioned it. It's easy for them. Brodin has a ton of time, and Bergeron's left with a tough choice right there. Because it's a penalty kill, he can't bust out there crazy. He can't go out of control, but he's got to get in the way. He's got to front him. And with that little Marco Sturm pick, it makes his life really difficult.
Well, that was Dynamic Duos, brought to you by Mass Mutual. And in spite of the fact that the Bruins dominated faceoffs in the first period, there were a couple of key ones for the Minnesota Wild, especially on the power play on the Bruins side of the ice. Some jump here to start the second period for Minnesota. Hartman in. He comes together with Forbert. A puck move, though, to Craig Smith along the half-boards. Reversed back around the net. There is Hartman sweeping one back up top to Dumba. Dumba will wind it into the trapezoid. Hartman out in front. Fiala tries to tee it up, and it was blocked. Taken by Zuccarello. Zuccarello looking for Fiala. He was checked by Derek Forbert. Could not tee up the shot. And now Marchand tries to weave his way across the Minnesota line. Comes together with Dumba, and those two tangle. And they end up in a pile on the ice.
Remember in that first period, Dumba had the near hit on Eric Halla just inside the Boston blue line. Well, you wonder if Dumba is a marked target the rest of this game.
Pasternak feathers one in. Halla in after it. Comes together with John Merrill in the corner. And now Merrill to the puck behind the net. Chips one out to center. Gathered in by Foligno. He'll get it deep. Grizzlick able to hold off the rookie Matt Boldy. But it's back up top. There's a block by Hall. Kept onside Merrill at the left point to Boldy behind the net. Halla in the far corner. But again, Boldy there to win the battle. Chip one up the boards, but a nice play by Hall to get it out to neutral ice. He's in a race for it. Beaten to the puck by Goligoski. And backed up by John Merrill.
Oh, Taylor Hall just took a stick in the face. He went tumbling to the ice. No call.
A couple of times he's ended up flat on his back, wondering where the officials were with a call. Kulikov sends it hard around. And some hustle from Goudreau along the half boards now. But Anton Bleed able to get one to Brennan Carlo, and he gets it out to the neutral zone. 2.5 minutes gone by in the second period. Stretch pass center circle tipped deep by Kalen Addison. So Addison is getting some opportunities up front as a forward. After we were told earlier today that Dean Evason did not think that was the role he was going to play tonight. But when he's been given some brief opportunities earlier this year to play that role, he's played well.
Yeah, maybe the energy wasn't all that much there for the Wild forwards that Evason had talked about, that they were well rested. So we'll keep an eye on that.
Well, Charlie. The forwards, of course, they all want to be out on the ice as much as they can, but it's tough to manage a bench 11-7. It just doesn't roll very easily. Every once in a while, you probably just want that even number.
Well, I made mention that Taylor Hall, and it's a stick you see right there. The stick of Marco Rossi clips Taylor Hall, and missed call is unintentional by Rossi, but Hall, even though he went down, wasn't able to draw the attention of the officials to make the call. Play on.
Taylor Hall, former number one overall pick back in 2010. The Bruins are his 15th, fourth in the last 3 years, still a two-time All-Star. And they are trying to trigger maybe some more production, specifically out of him, Bush, by moving Pasternak to his line.
Yeah, there's no doubt. And I think Pasternak, if you really ask Pasternak sometimes, I've had a conversation with him in the past, he's mentioned that he actually enjoys distributing the puck, even though we think of him as a real sniper. So maybe the hope is that he can try and find Hall on more occasions and get his game going and get his confidence up and bring that balanced attack for Boston every single night.
Pitlick through center after he turned it over and Dumba bailed him out.
Interesting talking about Hall too. He found success when he came over to Boston from Buffalo after a tough start in Buffalo, playing with David Krejci, who we mentioned in the first period, not here this year. And they were a very good pair. Taylor Hall had a good postseason, a good run with these guys. This year been a little slow, and he even said during the break, he's trying to work on getting inside, getting to the interior. He's been a shoot from the outside guy, and he said he's looking for a couple greasy goals.
Anton Bleed's dump in, hit the linesman. Threw the timing off. Kaprizov now with Bleed in the corner. Zuccarello there to support, and the Wild able to get the puck out. This will float the length of the ice just to the left of Swayman, and this will be icing on the Wild.
Let's go. Here's Jack Hughes. Pulls up Hughes. Backhand. He scores. In overtime, Jack Hughes wins it. It's going down right now.
Well, AJ, you mentioned about Taylor Hall getting inside. I think a lot of players could take that approach. And you think about last game, Pasternak, who's had his struggles as well. The goal against New Jersey, a prime example of it. He took the puck hard to the net, was able to find the rebound, ended up being the game-winning goal. So I think for a lot of guys, even though they're skilled and they want to be able to shoot from distance, I think the key has to be to get to prime scoring areas, and you can find success that way.
Harris Hall off the feed from Pasternak, and his hustle does draw a penalty.
Finally.
He got dumped right into Kokkonen, and all of the prices that have been paid by Taylor Hall tonight finally results in 2 minutes the other way.
Minnesota number 47, 2 minutes for interference.
Well, you see here, Pasternak kicks it outside, Hall trying to get to the inside, and that's one where Goligoski, not sure if he didn't know where the puck was, but the puck was long gone, and he just continued to stay with Hall right there, and Goligoski takes him down, and the missed call that didn't happen before it. Hall doesn't have to worry about it now as Boston gets a power play.
But that's exactly, we were just talking about that, getting to the interior for all these players in dangerous positions and either take a penalty or leave them to take a shot on net.
There's a drive off the setup to Pastrnak as the Bruins win the power play draw. And it is gobbled up by Kokkonen. Boston 1-for-2 on the power play as they scored the first goal of the game, and it was Taylor Hall that got his seventh of the season.
In this unit, I'll be interested to see if Pastrnak and Marchand ever switch sides and both go onto their onsides rather than the release one time, or just the way those guys can move the puck in their vision and just to change it up a little bit.
Jordy Benn fired it off the wall and all the way down. Pastrnak with a head of steam. To Marchand across the line. He drops one to the trailer Grizzly. Right side now taken by Bergeron. Cycling along the half boards and out of the point. A saucer pass from Marchand. That one-timer fanned on by Pastrnak. Loose in the corner, dug out by Foligno. Down went Pastrnak, thought he was tripped. No call by the officials. The power play continues, but easily could have been another two-man advantage for the Bruins.
Yeah, Nico Sturm got away with one right there. That was a clear-cut trip.
Pastrnak wraps it around the boards. Grizzlick a one-touch to the far side. Back up top Grizzly. There's Bergeron. Quick trigger. Did not get through. It caroms to the side of the net. Hammered around the wall. Marchand is able to keep it alive, though. He beats Hartman to the puck. Marchand controls. Right into the blue paint. Foligno gets dumped. There's a scramble for it. No whistle. It's still loose. They swing at it. Pastrnak puts it on net. And Kokkonen is able to find it in traffic with the glove.
Well, a good battle in front of the net. And a good job by Minnesota to battle as hard as they can. Foligno, Nick Foligno is able to get to the net right there. The shove by Dumba. I don't think it was a cross check. I think it was more of a shove more than anything. And then good defense there by Marcus Foligno, not allowing Pastrnak to come up with that puck. And there's a trip that was missed. Nico Sturm getting his stick on the skates of Pastrnak there.
Five shot attempts on this power play already for Boston, but this time Fiala is first to the puck for Minnesota. He shoots it all the way around with 35 seconds to go in the Bruin man advantage. Charlie Coyle weaves his way through center. Hands one off to Craig Smith. Hala sets things up. Hall had it go under his stick. Gave it away. Intercepted by Fiala. And a chance the other way. Shorthanded. Fiala with a drive. Swayman with the right pad save. Connor Duer had the rebound for a moment, but gave it up. And Hall comes back across the red line. Steps across the wild line. Hands one back. Hala. Wrist shot. Gobbled up by Kokkonen. And he will hold on with 1 second left in the power play.
Good look here. Coming back in the zone, they lost it. Fiala, Kevin Fiala was fantastic on the penalty kill for Minnesota. And that's just a Taylor Hall coming in off the rush. You know, that's what Bruce Cassidy was saying. They used to get a lot of power play goals just off the rush, the way that they can create and drive the net. They haven't been doing that this year. And you can see there's a little bit of creativity. And sometimes you just got to play hockey and not worry about setting up.
Frederick gets chased. Lazar moves in to take the draw, and Goudreau was able to win it. Or check that, Hartman. Off the stick of Anton Bleed. Matt Dumba gets a return. An intercept by Lazar. He feathers one forward for Bleed, but that's broken up once again very nicely by Brodin. Kaprizov tried to straddle the blue line, but took his teammates offside, so the Wild will retreat. 7 minutes gone by in the second period. All three goals scored in the first were on the power play. We have yet to have a five-on-five tally. And the Wild, they watched Taylor Hall score the first, but then they answered with a pair of their own to take the lead. As Bleed brings it across the line, Dumba was able to knock the puck out of midair, and it looks like he may have put the stick above the shoulder. So we'll step aside with the Wild on top. 2-1. It is hockey night on ESPN here in Boston. Power play from Zuccarello in the first period. Where does that quick trigger come from? Upper body strength. Where's the upper body strength come from? This in the offseason.
That looks like lower body strength or whatever. That's a lot of strength all over the place. What I'm impressed at, no shoes. Look at the weather. Most people would have mailed it in on a rainy day if you got an outdoor workout, not Kaprizov. I don't know if that looks like Kawhi or Russia. I'm not really sure, but you can see the work is being put in.
So, Boosh, you're not his workout partner?
No, I would mail it in and say, sorry, Kirill, day off today for Boosh if we're going outside in the rain. You could slip and fall, AJ.
Yeah. Yeah, that was not a glamorous-looking workout facility either. That looked like it was just in somebody's backyard picking up really heavy things.
No excuses, right?
Old school.
Steel attire, right? Check. Off of a monster truck.
Right.
Kettlebell, maybe you pay for that, right? The ropes. That thing must cost you, what, $150? To get that workout?
Maybe cheaper than that if you steal the tire.
Right, that's what I'm saying. You steal
exactly.
The tire.
You're factoring in the stolen tire to your budget.
That's a lot of money, that tire, I'm sure.
Gotcha.
It was interesting when we got a chance to catch up with Dean Evason. He was talking about Kaprizov, and he said he came into his office recently. He was upset and wasn't sure exactly why. Was it ice time? Was it the way he was playing? He said the most impressive thing was it had nothing to do with himself. It had everything to do with the fact that the team was losing. He said he hated losing, and he was a winner. He had to figure out how this team was going to get back on the winning side.
Pressure possibly put on here as a shot from the point from Kulikov. Carried in on Swayman. Good work behind the net by the rookie Matt Boldy to get that cycle started and create a scoring opportunity as Kulikov has it. Center circle, Boldy brings it across to the right point. Marcus Foligno behind the net, hoping for Marco Rossi. Got both of the rookies out there together with Marcus Foligno. Not sure that I remember a shift earlier in the game where the two rookies were playing together for Minnesota. As that shot is sticked up and out of play by Kokkonen. Back to Arda.
Thank you very much, Bob. We'll take you to the Flyers and Penguins, also on ESPN+. It was 3-0 Penguins, but Cam Atkinson for the Philadelphia Flyers with his 14th of the year into the neutral zone. A 2-on-1, takes the shot himself. Back to you, Bob, so I can go carry my tires.
As long as you don't steal them, Arda. Matt Boldy on the right, number 12, the 12th overall pick in the 2019 draft, and Marco Rossi, number 23, the 9th overall pick in the 2020 draft. So that is the future sitting side by side on the Minnesota Wild bench, brought up together, making their debut tonight, and now Boosh playing shifts together.
And they've looked comfortable. And keep in mind, when you have 11 forwards, there's going to be different combinations. So that's why they were able to get a shift out there together. Bill Guerin made mention, Dean Evason as well, that these guys are going to be Minnesota Wild players for a long time, getting a terrific opportunity. Keep in mind also, this Wild team is going to be in cap crunch trouble in a couple of seasons. So it's going to be important that these young guys get comfortable, get acclimated, and eventually be big parts of this Wild team going forward in the future.
Well, I like the way Dean Evason said it. He said, you two are going to be Minnesota Wild players, so why not today? Let's get them in the lineup. I know that Minnesota Wild fans have been chomping at the bit to see them out here, and they have sort of come hand in hand. You hear them always paired together.
Taylor Hall across the line, carries deep, sends one of the right wing half boards. Pasternak now has it with some space. Pasternak, a little toe drag, kept onside. He's got it right back in between the circles. Unable to tee it up though was Holla. And Duer back the other way. Banks it in, goes after his own dumping. Gets it into the trapezoid. It's wound around the boards. And now Hall takes a hit, chops it to center. Pasternak, nifty little stick handling move into the skates of Holla, and it's another turnover. And Pitlick tried to feed one ahead to Zuccarello, just a little bit out of his reach. And now John Moore moves it for Boston. Again, Boston also tonight playing at least for one game without Charlie McAvoy. An injury that, according to Bruce Cassidy, is not all that serious. He is day to day. And now we've got a drop of the gloves as Frederick is going to go, and a couple of other players are jumping in and joining the fray. Kulikov and Frederick. And the linesman letting them go at it. Oh,
Oh, that fight certainly will get this crowd livened up. Kaprizov took a big hit along the wall. Kulikov came to his defense, and Frederick is able to answer the bell. It's getting loud here in Boston. As you see right here, Frederick, the hit on Kaprizov, and then the theatrics after that.
And Monday, the national championship game, Georgia, Alabama. And Wednesday, the first match of the Spanish Super Cup semis between Real Madrid and Barcelona. Kirill Kaprizov, after this hit, Bush went to the locker room.
Yeah, another look at it. He got tangled up initially with the one Bruin player. Then Frederick came over, finished the hit. And then you could see after that, Kaprizov in significant amount of discomfort, heads down the tunnel and into the locker room. That doesn't look good. That does not look like a guy that is going to be able to shake off. But we will keep an eye on the Minnesota Wild bench to see if he returns. One thing about Frederick, he is not afraid to stand up for himself. He proved it a lot last year. He is one tough customer. And although Kulikov may have gotten the initial jump on Frederick, I think at the end, you got to give the win to Frederick on that fight.
Frederick and Kulikov having a chat. Now that the fight's over, kind of break it down, some post-fight analysis. Seems like a pretty pleasant conversation across the scorer's table. But the Bruins are going to get tagged with an extra two-minute penalty here. And Minnesota will go on the power play. Again, they're 2-for-4. Both of their goals being scored with the man advantage in the first period.
Keep in mind, no Kaprizov once again. They didn't have him on the last power play. That's why Kalen Addison was taking his spot. So a big loss for the Wild on this power play with no Kaprizov once again.
And the Wild win the draw. There's a wrist shot right into the chest of Swayman from Marco Rossi.
Good opportunity for Rossi off that face-off win. And Rossi, who's more known as a passer, got terrific vision. I think probably a little surprised that he had that much time. An easy save for Jeremy Swayman.
And Bush, they gave Trent Frederick an extra 2 minutes for boarding in addition to the 5 for fighting. So it is Craig Smith in the box serving the Frederick Miner. And it is a power play for Minnesota. And the Bruins angle one in, but offside at the Minnesota line.
And I think if you're Bruce Cassidy, you're telling a guy like Trent Frederick, you play hard and you hit the other team's best players. They have no problem with that. I think if you're the Boston Bruins, you'll kill that penalty every single time. That's the message on the bench. They don't mind Frederick taking a penalty like that, sticking up for himself, especially when you're targeting the other team's best.
Well, it's interesting. Look at the Bruins. Right now, their power play is 11th in the league, but the last two seasons, it's been top three. So I think that mentality of the confidence in their penalty kill, they still have it, even if it's not quite as strong. It's a little bit more pedestrian this season.
Fiala across the line, and it certainly diminishes the Minnesota power play significantly. Without Kaprizov, their best player out there is Marchand. Short-handed, kills some time behind the net, wraps it all the way back up to Charlie Coyle. Coyle content to rag it down into the corner and control and kill some more time, down to a minute 15 to go in the Minnesota power play. Coyle again, physical on Goligoski behind the net. Fiala, rink wide, Hartman across and feathers it deep. Fiala plays it up the boards. Hartman has it. Wrist shot to flex up and out of play.
It's showtime, and the NHL All-Star Fan Vote lets you choose the captains. Vote today and decide which NHL stars will take center stage in Las Vegas. Vote on the NHL app or NHL.com/vote.
Some power play time once again for number 12 in white, the rookie Matt Boldy, as he's out there with Goudreau on the draw, wins it back to Brodin. Brodin straight away, sets up Boldy. Boldy holds, shoots one towards the net, and that's padded out with the right leg by Swayman and cleared all the way down.
Good decision there by Boldy, assertive, didn't waste time. He was looking for either a tip off that shot or a shot pass off the pads, but I like the decision making by Boldy.
Dumba carries deep, throws one towards the slot. A bouncing puck. Goudreau settles it down. 25 seconds to go on the power play. Winds it into the far corner. Dumba plays it up high. That's thrown into the trapezoid. Goudreau controls. Dumba along the half boards. Kicks it to Freddie Goudreau. He'll play it to Boldy in the right wing corner. Boldy. Rink wide pass. That was loose for a moment. Sent deep by Brodin. And now back up to Brodin. Dumba has it. Goudreau missed a one-timer on the pass from Boldy. And it floats just back across the Boston line in time for the penalty to expire. Boldy now five aside, brings it across. Sets up Foligno. Back to Boldy. Shoots and scores! The BC Kid returns home and scores his first National Hockey League goal to stretch the Wild lead to 3-1.
What a night for Boldy. And he deserves it. Terrific work as you get a look at some family members in the stands. Boldy off the regroup. Nice play here to kick it out to Foligno and then find some open ice, and then a good feed by Foligno to find him on the cross ice feed. But even before that, Boldy made several good plays on this power play. He's looked comfortable. The feed, the finish. What a moment to score your first NHL goal in your hometown.
Look at some of his family members up there. We mentioned it earlier. He said he thinks there's about nine of them here, plus a bunch of Boston College players up with Coach Jerry York. He played with them the last two seasons, so a lot of it, he still said, says his best friends there at Boston College. So what a moment. You know what I liked about, he's known as a shooter, and he's got a great shot, but he dishes the puck, and then he presents himself. He gets open, and he, watch him here, he's got eyes up, and it's a good back cross-seam pass, and then he keeps his stick in the position. And then a beautiful finish.
Well, talk about the dream scenario. Score your first National Hockey League goal in your hometown, in your NHL debut in front of your college teammates. Can't script it any better than that. At the right point, Goligoski. Now with a two-goal lead. Sends it to John Merrill at the left point. Another penalty upcoming on Boston. Kokkonen heads to the bench. The extra attacker on for the Minnesota Wild. And it is touched up by Brendan Carlo. And we'll see who goes. It might be Bergeron for the second
Boston
time tonight.
Penalty interference.
Patrice Bergeron takes his second minor penalty of the night.
And Minnesota will go back on the power play. In your left-hand side, the finish by Bergeron along the wall. The puck was not there. You could call interference. You could call boarding. The right call was made there. But for Matt Boldy, a night he will not forget. And, you know, good for him. He's faced some adversity. He got cut from a World Junior team when he was 18 years old, came back, won it as a 19-year-old, played a significant role on that team. This year, ankle injury during training camp, then re-injured in November when he had a chance to get called up, and he stuck with it, and now he's getting an opportunity and he's making the most of it.
Some question whether this puck went up and out directly from the defender, but they're saying it was tipped. No penalty, no added penalty for the Bruins.
And AJ, as best you can tell, still no sign of Kirill Kaprizov down there on the bench, I believe. He is not out, obviously, as part of the power play group, so the best player for Minnesota, I think, still being looked at back in the locker room.
Yeah, I haven't seen him yet. I think that he would be out there if he was back on the bench. You know, you're talking about both these guys there, Steve Evison, keeping an eye on these things. But Patrice Bergeron, Bob, you mentioned it, second penalty of the game, unusual for a perennial Selke candidate, and such a critical part of the penalty kill. So twice they've had to kill penalties without the captain.
He's won the Selke four times, and as you said, every other year it seems he is in the discussion to win it. Carlo along the goal line, and the puck gathered in by Charlie Coyle, and he pitchforks it out to neutral ice. Still a minute 25 to go in this power play for Minnesota with a 3-1 lead. Hartman center circle. Off the stick for the skates of Haula. Carlo gets it to Forbert. He's able to pitch one forward. Coyle had his pocket picked. Zuccarello on the doorstep, denied by Swayman. after Marco Rossi, another of the rookies for the Minnesota Wild, with a nifty little pick of the pocket to create the offensive opportunity.
Finally, the Bruins can get a change of the forwards. Tired legs out there, this long change in the second period.
Fiala across the line. Zuccarello gets it back to him. Chip to Zuccarello along the half boards. Matt Zuccarello tries to dig it free from Bleed, and Bleed able to clear. The rush forms up for the Wild. Still 28 seconds to go on the power play. Dumba sends it along the wall. Boldy chips it behind the net. That is back to the point. Dumba cannot keep it in. And once again, the Wild have to regroup in center ice. Foligno, hop on over the stick of Boldy, ended up on his brother's stick as it's sent all the way down by Nick Foligno. Back the other way comes Dumba. Feathers one deep for Gaudreau. Connor Clifton there first. Gaudreau took it away, put it on the side of the net. And looking for another goal was Boldy, sweeping in a puck that had to be covered up with the glove by Jeremy Swayman.
Well, how about
24 Minnesota Minor penalty
interference? His first goal in his first NHL game. The local kid, Matt Boldy, the finish, 3-1 Minnesota, and some approving family members to go along with it. Game for Matt Boldy, and look, he's putting in the work. First on the scene, wins a battle on the forecheck, hangs on the pucks. This is good stuff from any NHL player, let alone a first player in his first NHL game. Then look at the decision here. Quick, get it to the net, looking for a tip. Doesn't happen. Able to back off the Boston defense, find some open ice, and you talk about scoring goals. That's a goal scorer's goal right there, as he's able to put it top shelf. Good stuff from Boldy here so far tonight.
Bruins back on the power play, though, as Dumba took an interference minor just as we went to break. Pastrnak with a drive, save. The rebound. Oh, somehow it was stuffed on the way in as Marchand, it looked like, had an open net, but there was some traffic in front. Pastrnak, left point Grizzly. His drive into traffic again. Loose. The rebound. Score! He missed the first time, not the second time. Marchand lights the lamp. And the Bruins, a power play goal. They're within one.
Well, they took advantage and they made sure that they had possession right from the drop of the puck, and they moved the puck. You can see Foligno parked in front, and it's Brad Marchand making no doubt about that second one. The first time he had a little trouble corralling it because it came to his backhand. Watch here. Look at that gaping net. Not much he's going to be able to do. What a beautiful setup, too, from the front of the net. Bruce Cassidy was talking about how they needed to take advantage of Patrice Bergeron in that spot a little bit more.
Yeah, to me, it's a heads-up play by Bergeron, recognizing, and he knows that Marchand is on that back door. It's a no-look play, but he just knows he's there. He could have held on to that puck and buried it back into Kakinen, but getting the sense that he knows where Marchand is, take a chance, and Marchand was able to finish it off.
Yeah, I think Bergeron is one of the best in the league at that bumper spot, and he really plays it like a bumper spot. He can shoot, he can bump the puck around, and in that situation, he can distribute it with a no-look pass, as you mentioned.
Hall's wrister deflects wide. Here's Pastrnak looking for the equalizer. The Bruins putting some more pressure on. Pastrnak cycles one along. John Moore throws it towards the net into the skates of Dumba. Hala along the goal line, one on two. Nico Sturm tries to dig it free, pokes it back to Dumba, and it's reversed to Brodin.
Dumba's got the wrong-handed stick there. His stick was broken. He was given a left-handed stick. He's a right-handed shot. Fortunately, he was able to make a little backhand shuffle there, but tough spot to be in when you got the wrong curve.
3.5 minutes to go in the second period. Zuccarello backhands one ahead for Hartman. Zuccarello has it. Wrist shot save made by Swayman. And it keeps the deficit only one for the Bruins as Zuccarello misses a point-blank opportunity.
Yeah, an important save for Jeremy Swayman. Your team gets a goal back. You cut the deficit to one. The pressure here by Hartman, but Swayman was on top of it, could recognize the play was in trouble, was able to get to the top of the crease. Good solid save there by Swayman. I mean, the importance for a goaltender when you come into games, you want to tell yourself, three or less. That's the mindset of most goaltenders when they come to a game, three or less. You do that, you give yourself a chance to win. And Swayman's at the point in this game where everything has to be swallowed and you have to shut the door to give your team a chance to battle back.
You know what I liked about that play from the Minnesota perspective is their quick attack. They went, Dean Evason has talked about going north-south more. Quick touches right in front of me in that neutral zone. They come in the Hartman pursuit and they get a good opportunity off of it.
Well, the Bruins look to big break back the other way. Foligno floats one in though, and it is gobbled up by Kapkinen, and he will hold on. Again, plenty of upcoming games on ESPN Plus and ESPN. To make sure you're aware of Detroit San Jose, ESPN Plus exclusive Tuesday night at 10:30. Couple of games coming up next Thursday on ESPN, right back here at TD Garden for the Flyers and Bruins, Columbus at Carolina on ESPN Plus next Thursday night as well. And then January 17th, a matinee Montreal at Arizona on ESPN Plus. Jordy Benn sends one out to the neutral zone. A loose puck corralled by Hartman, brings it across, wrist shot blocked on the way in. And the Foligno brothers both out there as Nick Foligno sent it to center. There's Jordy Benn. Long stretch pass, broken up at the red line by Connor Clifton. So it's right back to Jordy Benn.
Be interesting to see how this game progresses too, with only 10 forwards right now for the Minnesota Wild and how their legs hold up.
Hartman moves in. Chips it around the shelf, past Zuccarello, taken by Forbert. Forbert up to the half wall, and it's poked out to neutralize by Oscar Steen. All the way down into the Minnesota end, coming up on 2 minutes to go in the second period of what has been a fun game to watch. It has been a game, Boosh, that's had a lot of jump right from the start.
Yeah, there's been good energy. The specialty teams have come through on both sides. There's been physicality. We've had a fight. We pretty much have had it all.
Marchand with a takeaway, turning it right back the other way is Matt Boldy. The rookie comes across the line, celebrating his first ever National Hockey League goal tonight. There's a drive from the point from Goligoski, and a left pad save made by Swayman. Up high to Merrill, another drive. That one through traffic caroms to the far corner. Goligoski pinches in, sends it around to the half wall, but it's out to neutral ice. Marchand. That pass off the tape of Craig Smith. Smith in the right wing corner. Goligoski takes it away from him, supported by Merrill. Minute 15 to go in the second period. Now Kevin Fiala waits for some help and backhands one to Merrill. Right in front of the penalty box doors, they do battle. Forbert comes away with the puck. Here's Pastrnak. One on two across the line. He's stoned by Nico Sturm. Pastrnak gets the puck back. Lazar floats one in. That's paddled to the half boards by Kokkonen and all the way back to the Bruins lot. 45 seconds to go in the second period. Taylor Hall dropped one, but no one was there. Freddie Goudreau with an intercept. He rushes the other way towards the net. And on the weak side, that was put on. Swayman, though, was able to make the save on Connor Duehr.
Well, I think Duehr was able to get a lot on that shot. It allowed Swayman to get across. An important save here late in the second.
Dumbo with a stretch pass. Duehr finds Sturm. Sturm leverages his way behind the net but pays the price. Duehr is there. Sturm's slow to get up after a big hit from Carlo. There's a drive by Brodin. That goes wide. Dumba has the puck at the right point. 10 seconds to go in the period. Keeps it onside to Brodin. Zuccarello. Left side, there's a club save made by Swayman off the drive from Hartman. Skated free by Oscar Steen, and that will end the period with the Minnesota Wild on top by one. We showed you that Minnesota unbeaten so far this year in regulation when they have the lead after one, and they are also unbeaten in regulation when they have the lead after two. Our score at the end of two periods, Minnesota 3.
Yeah, a tough situation for Minnesota. All playing with 11 forwards to start the game. They lose another forward in Kirill Kaprizov, the hit by Trent Frederick. We did not see Kaprizov return, but on the positive side of things, Matt Boldy making his NHL debut has looked good and looked comfortable all night, was able to finish on that feed from Marcus Foligno, scoring his first National Hockey League goal in his hometown. So some bad and some good for the Minnesota Wild.
This is ESPN Hockey Night presented by Expedia, just about set for the start of the third period, a one-goal game. The Wild on top. Bob Bischusen, Brian Boucher, A.J. Molesko, and Bush, an old goaltender. There was some goaltending news made today for the Boston Bruins. Tuukka Rask might be back in the mix before too long.
Yes, it's a story that is percolating here in Boston. Tuukka Rask was sent down to Providence, signed a professional tryout down in Providence with the hope that he would play in a couple of games this weekend. Unfortunately, those games have been postponed and he will not play, but it is a big story here in Boston. I mean, you got a three-headed monster in goal and two guys that have been here all year long in Jeremy Swayman and Linus Allmark that are looking over their shoulder knowing that Tuukka Rask, who has been practicing for some time, will eventually be signed here in Boston. And you wonder how it's going to play out. I think it's a tough situation for three guys. It's a tough situation for a young guy in Jeremy Swayman, who has played very well. It looks like he will be the guy that eventually goes down to Providence. I don't know if that situation is entirely fair, but for a young guy you want to play, it's a situation that bears watching and keeping tabs on, as it's going to get even more interesting as time goes on.
Yeah, and you look at Jeremy Swayman, he's waiver exempt, so it makes sense when you're looking at all the big picture and the business side of it to send him down, and that's what Bruce Cassidy sort of alluded to this morning. But he, over the whole season, he's actually had the better body of work. Now, Linus Allmark has looked very good over the last month, and since Tuukka Rask has been skating with the team over the month of December, these two goalies have elevated their game. Bruce Cassidy would not go so far to say it was because of Tuukka Rask's return to the team and the competitive drive. He said they're playing better, but had a chance to talk quickly to goalie coach Mike Dunham. He said Tuukka Rask looks great, really comfortable on the ice.
Marchand attacks to start off the period for the Bruins, looking for a wraparound as Craig Smith. That was denied. Bergeron sweeps one back to the point. Kept onside by Carlo. His shot stopped by Kakinen. Loose right wing faceoff dot. Swept at by Carlo. And he gets tied up with Fiala. Fiala able to wedge the puck out across the Minnesota line. And the Bruins will make a change. Bush, how much would it affect you if you were an Allmark or a Swayman, that news, when you hear that, you know, the goaltender that's got the much longer and more accomplished resume, and now we've got a fight as Foligno drops the gloves, and he's going to go with Frederick.
Well, Foligno, the much tougher of the customers versus Dmitry Kulikov. That's the guy you want sending the message to Frederick. They did not like the hit on Kaprizov, and the initial fight by Kulikov, although it was a situation where Kulikov stood up for his teammate, that's not the guy they want doing it. You could see last period Marcus Foligno sending a message to Frederick that he will have to answer the bell. And here to start this third period, it's exactly how it played
Boston
out.
Boston number 11, and 2 minutes for high sticking.
Didn't go as
fighting.
Well for Frederick as the
Minnesota
last fight against Kulikov went.
5 minutes for fighting.
Seeing that Foligno is a much tougher customer.
And Frederick gets the extra two for high sticking. So after all of this and the five for fighting to both, it's going to be a power play for Minnesota.
And that last punch by Foligno while Frederick was on his way down, I think it just missed Frederick, which was probably a good thing, as you see Nick Foligno, the older brother of Marcus, looking on.
I got a glimpse of him on the bench during the fight, and he's cheering his teammate on, and didn't seem to be too bothered that it was his little brother.
I think Frederick was surprised to find out that he got the extra two. He was met by Craig Smith in the box and was completely shocked.
So the Bruins already adding to a season high in penalty minutes, and they have allowed a couple of power play goals to Minnesota, but now we're going to get back to four aside. The rookie Marco Rossi gets tagged two, it looks like, for tripping.
Minnesota number 23, 2 minutes tripping.
See here, Rossi trying to pursue the puck, and
yeah, you know, he argued it right away, and I actually think he's got an argument there. Carlo looked like he went down on his own.
Yeah, I didn't see the stick on the skates at all. I think it was one of those situations where Carlo could feel the pressure, leaned into Rossi,
and in a lot of ways helped draw that penalty. So a headsy play there by Carlo to draw that penalty and kill the Minnesota power play quickly.
So Brandon Carlo, the veteran play that puts Rossi in the box. And it will be a very brief potential 12-second power play for the Bruins on the back end. But that erases the wild man advantage. So we'll have a minute 48 of 4-on-4. Hartman wins the draw. Swept back to him by Goligoski. Merrill outlets to Zuccarello. Zuccarello brings it across the line. Puts on the brakes in the left wing corner. Digs it free. Good job by Taylor Hall, though. He couldn't clear the puck. Zuccarello plays one out in front, trying to drag it to the forehand was Hartman. And Swayman was able to cover it up with the glove before Hartman could tee it up.
Well, Swayman went for the poke check, missed it, but a good job here by Merrill to keep that play alive. And Zuccarello quickly recognizing that Hartman was all alone in front of the net. Hartman not able to corral as he goes from backhand to forehand. The poke check, I think, and enough of a disruption to kill that play. Good job by Swayman.
Yeah, risky play there by Hartman. Stay down there. He was way behind the play if Merrill had not kept that puck in the zone, and Merrill was outmanned. So lucky play, but almost a good opportunity.
We have been told, by the way, from Minnesota that Kirill Kaprizov will not return tonight. He does have an upper body injury. So the hit he took from Frederick, that started all of the fisticuffs, as Frederick's fought a couple of times now. Based on the hit on Kaprizov, he left the ice and will not return. Pasternak through traffic. A little toe drag, but his wrist shot blocked up and out of play.
Nikita Kucherov.
Dive into that pile.
Learn from Pasta.
The Minnesota Wild lose their best player midway through the game, and yet they still have the one-goal lead. About 2.5 minutes gone by here in the third period. Bob Schusen here with AJ Molesko and Brian Boucher at TD Garden on ESPN Hockey Night. Boudreau in the right wing corner leaves it for Fiala, and an errant pass, missed connection with Brodin. A Wild gather in center, and Fiala brings it right back across. Stick handles into the corner. Takes a hit, loses the puck. He was knocked down by Grizzlick. And now Grizzlick gets into it with Dumba. Coyle the other way. In between the circles. That pass ended up on the tape. A Pasternak, but he couldn't tee up the shot. Connor Clifton wheels and deals and brings it back across. Drops to Pasternak. He'll fire one. That deflects wide. And it's up in the air. And controlled as it drops into the trapezoid, but not clear. Bergeron has it along the half boards. He'll bring it beneath the goal line. Hook a pass back up to Moore. Out of the penalty box is Smith. So a very brief Boston power play. And there is Marchand leaning in to a one-timer. That's gobbled up by Kakinen. Let's check in with Arda.
Thank you very much, Bob. An update in the matchup between the Pittsburgh Penguins and Philadelphia Flyers. Jake Guentzel. This team has been on fire, and he has been the beneficiary. 18th of the year, 13th on the road. It's now 6-1 after Brian Boyle scored a shorthanded goal.
Pittsburgh starting to get their footing.
I guess so. It's going to be 10 in a row now, and the
not
Flyers.
Bad.
Yeah, the Flyers seem to be going the other way. They've had the COVID issues and tough road trip out west. It didn't end well, and certainly not much better here tonight.
Power play over. It was very brief. We are back at five aside. The Bruins wind one around, clipped it along the half boards, shot one through the blue paint. It caught the wall, and it's all the way back down into Boston ice. An intercept by Duehr. Wrist shot, chest save made by Swayman. Paula to the puck. First there in the right wing corner, though, to the defenseman John Merrill. Had his pocket picked, though, nicely by John Moore. Pasternak with a floater just out of the reach of Holland. He'll wind it right back to Pasternak. Pasternak uses strength, but gave it away to Boldy. And now the Bruins gather with 15:43 to go in the third period of a one-goal game here in Boston. Pastrnak again. Comes together with Goudreau. Pastrnak winds it around. Now it's Riley at the left point. There's a drive as he set up Hall, and that went just wide. And behind the net, Howler. Pastrnak plays it up high. Once again, it's Riley. Right point now, Carlo. Carlo floats one in. An intended pass to Pastrnak. He's got it in the right wing corner. Right back up top to Carlo. Carlo through traffic. Glove down by Kokkonen with plenty of traffic right in front of him. But he was able to get clear sight and make the save.
Oh, good shift here by Boston as they're able to get some traffic in front of the net. You see here the traffic in front there by Halla, and Kokkonen is able to look around it. Good stuff there by Kokkonen to look through that screen as Boston spent some significant time in the offensive zone.
So the faceoff in the Minnesota end to the left of Kokkonen. Coyle wins it. And Steen throws it towards the net. That was blocked before it got through to Kokkonen. Pinching in along the left wing wall, though, is John Moore to put some pressure on. Charlie Coyle now has it. Sends it to the right point. Grizzly, one-time drive. Chest save made by Kokkonen. And the rebound controlled to Zuccarello. And he's able to get it out to the red line.
How about the urgency from the Boston Bruins right now? And quick strike right back in.
It doesn't it seem, AJ, like their defense has been much more aggressive to start off this period?
Absolutely. See John Moore coming into the lineup here, and he's going down the wall. You got Oscar Steen recovering for him, but they are all over them right now from the point.
Coyle back up to Moore. Moore's shot off the shaft of the stick of Fiala. And now it is sent high in the air, just ladled down between the circles. Hoping for it is Zuccarello. Backhands one that was blocked by Moore, gathered by Coyle, and he'll send it to Grizzlick behind the net.
Yeah, you can see it's a simplified approach for Boston, and they're getting it to the point and quickly getting it back to the net. I mean, they're not wasting any time recognizing down by a goal, try and get traffic there, get pucks there. Much more simplified approach, and it's led to some chances.
The twig snaps for Ben. And now the Bruins put more pressure on. Bergeron and Smith work the puck in the corner. Smith puts it on the outside of the net. Bergeron trying to dig it free, and it is covered up with Kokkonen's glove. 13:52 to go in the third period. The Wild with a 3-2 lead on the Bruins. ESPN Hockey Night is presented by Expedia. It matters who you travel with.
America's brightest stage.
You're not entertained.
NHL All-Star Weekend, February 4th and 5th on ESPN and ABC.
And the NHL All-Star Fan Vote allows fans to cast their votes to determine the captain for each division's team. In the 2022 Honda NHL All-Star Weekend, Las Vegas, we'll have it for you February 4th and 5th on ESPN and then ABC. Vote today on the NHL app or visit nhl.com/vote. That's four pretty good candidates.
I would say
the fans have chosen.
Yeah, I would say all very deserving.
Yeah.
And, you know, for Ovechkin, what a year he is having. What a year he is having. And it's not all the power play. A lot of five-on-five point production from the grade eight. He's got me believing that he's going to break Gretzky's record at some point.
You know what's been impressive to me? It's not, you mentioned the five-on-five versus power play. They're also, even his first couple power play goals weren't from that typical release
right.
spot, right? They
yeah.
weren't from Ovi's office.
Finding different ways to score.
He's evolving his game, and he did that even the year they went on to win, right? I mean, he really was able, with the coaching of Barry Trotz, he was able to change the way he played, become a leader, and it's amazing to see how he has continued to evolve.
That's AJ Molesko along with Brian Boucher, and I'm Bob Bouchouzin, and now you are about to enjoy some of my best work. As we take you inside the rush, we bring you closer to ice level to experience the speed and at times violence of this game from right up close. The Bruins and Wild with 13 and a half to go. We certainly would never want to hurt our ratings on ESPN. We love when people are home watching on television, but if you have never been to a National Hockey League game in person, you have to go.
Yeah.
You can't appreciate this sport as much as you. It is an in-person sport if there ever was one.
There's
so
no doubt.
Wonderful.
You watch it live, you'll be hooked forever, especially if you got a good seat.
Nice pass save by Kokkonen as the rush was created by Hall to set up all the way down. Icing waved off.
And the shot attempts in this period for Boston, 14-5. Through the first two periods, Minnesota had a plus 10 shot attempt differential. So Boston getting pucks to the net much more regularly now.
Typically, they are a team that shoots a lot more. But this third period, they've upped it.
Pastrnak went down, and he is slow to get up behind the play. Legowski brings it across. Drop pass to Fiala. Sets up a one-timer from Hartman. And Swayman makes the save. Here's Zuccarello weaving his way through traffic. Ben at the left point. One-timer fanned on by Fiala. Charlie Coyle steps to center. That's broken up at the Minnesota line. Ben, center ice pass off the stick of Fiala. They'll peel off for a chain. Carlo hit the back of Charlie Coyle. And now once again, Ben has it. Banks one, looking for Nico Sturm. He is stood up by Forbert at the Boston line. And now a delayed offsides whistle that will bring the draw back out to neutral ice.
Well, we lost one star player in this game so far in Kirill Kaprizov. And for David Pastrnak, a scary moment for him as he gets tangled up with John Merrill. You can see that left skate goes into the boards. Pastrnak got up slowly and eventually got to the bench. Looks like he is okay. But anytime you go into the wall like that, certainly is a cause for concern for any fan.
Yeah, he's right next to me. Seems to be, he's joking with the trainer. Seems to be no worse for the wear.
The Bruins have dominated faceoffs tonight. They have now won 35 to the 20 for Minnesota. Smith across the line, but a pass behind Bleed. And now Grizzlick has to retreat. Flying down the right wing is Curtis Lazar. They set one up. Frederick, or rather, Bleed misses the net. Back to the right point to Grizzlick. Left side, there's a drive by Moore. Gobbled up once again by Kaapo Kakkonen, and he will hold on.
Well, a good opportunity for Boston off the rush. And you can see Lazar carries it, kicks it out. Then a nice cross-ice feed to Anton Bleed. Bleed not able to hit the net on that opportunity. But a good job by Boston to create an opportunity off the rush. That pass was made by Craig Smith. Bleed back in the lineup here tonight. Looking to find a way to get on the scoreboard. You can see him shaking his head knowing that puck has to hit the net. Good opportunity miss for Boston there.
We see the perfection line back together here for Boston.
And there's Pastrnak putting one on. I saw that as well, AJ, is down a goal midway through the third period. Bruce Cassidy pushes the button to put Pastrnak back up with Marchand and Bergeron. So we'll see if that produces an equalizer. As we remind you again, we've got plenty of more hockey that you should be aware of on national television. Coming up Sunday afternoon, a matinee between the Stars and Blues on NHL Network. And Tuesday night, exclusive coverage on ESPN Plus at 10:30. Red Wings in San Jose to take on the Sharks. And a doubleheader on Wednesday on TNT. Canadiens Bruins and then Maple Leafs Coyotes. Marchand flips one to center. That's deflected. Taken by Grizzlick, and he'll send it deep. Wound around by Kokkonen. Zuccarello with a one-touch pass. Hartman through center. Hartman across the line. Drags to the corner. Winds it around the wall, hoping for Fiala. Beaten to the puck by Taylor Hall. Moved by Clifton. Hall has it. Feathers one forward. And it's out center circle. And hammered right back in by Jonas Brodin. Hall with a step to center. Hall across the line. Drops one off to Smith. A pass to Howlett. Howlett looks to center. That was blocked. Smith has it in the corner. And an errant pass past Riley. And all the way back out to neutral ice. But the net off the moorings behind the play. So we get a whistle past the midway point of the third period. The Wild on top of the Bruins by one. As we are at TD Garden. A terrific night here.
Ola Charles Adams wanted a mascot that was fast and strong. but it also needed to be brown and gold, because that was the color scheme and the logo of his 50 grocery stores. A secretary suggested the Bruin, a bear that is fast, wicked strong, and yeah, brown and gold.
And eventually that became the black and gold of the Boston Bruins. Stanley Cup championship banners adorn the top of TD Garden at one end. And of course, plenty of NBA World Championship banners adorn the other end, as this became title town over the last 15 years again. It's a long time. You felt like there were some droughts that they had to suffer through in Boston. But boy, they go 6 months without a parade in this town. It feels like a long time.
Yeah, they've got signs up all over the city. End the drought. It's been 6 months. My kids, they don't know anything other than sports teams around here being successful.
Yeah, as a Mets, Jets, Rangers, and Knicks fan, I need to collectively tell them all to shush. There's the rookie Marco Rossi behind the net. Crowd trying to urge the Bruins on into a comeback with 9 minutes to go in the third period. All chips one in. Marcus Foligno first to the puck, winds it around to Jonas Brodin, and it's pitched out to center. Carlo on the back pedal, one touch. Hall with a step down the right wing side. Wrist shot. That's up to the high glass behind Kakinen.
Interesting, you look at the Wild right now. They do not look like they've missed a step despite playing with only 11 forwards and for half the game with 10 forwards. And you just look at the way that he's playing them all equally, and Rossi getting out there, just got off the ice, but in one goal game, getting some really good experience here and playing great.
And again, the Wild trying to survive this game without Kirill Kaprizov, as he left midway through the game with an upper body injury. Coil in, backhander, a save is made, the rebound put wide. Chrisley puts it into the blue paint, and it is covered up by Kakinen.
Well, Bruce Cassidy had talked about it with his hockey club, about some guys needing to find inside ice to get inside, and this is a terrific play here by Charlie Coyle, able to get around John Merrill and get to a prime scoring area. I don't know if Coyle was able to get a lot on this backhand, but to get to that inside, I think the help by Zuccarello there to get a stick on Coyle didn't allow Coyle to get a lot on that opportunity, but a good skilled play there by Coyle to get inside.
That was a great look with our cameras there. You had five Minnesota Wilds all in the picture and just Charlie Coyle. They were standing around a little bit again, talking perhaps a little bit of fatigue, but they've got to prevent the Bruins from getting to that inside ice.
Stretch pass just off the tip of the stick of Nico Sturm, and it's right back down into Minnesota's end. Merrill makes no mistake, hammers it right back out in front of the penalty box doors, and it's back on his stick. And we mentioned Kaprizov being out tonight, certainly bears repeating as well. We talked about it in the first period that the Bruins are without Charlie McAvoy, and of course is a premier defenseman they played the whole game with, as he is day-to-day with an injury of his own.
Yeah, and he eats up about 24 minutes a night. That's a lot of ice time to cover.
So both teams without a premier performer with 7.5 minutes to go. Goligoski ahead to Zuccarello. Off the red line boards, and it's played deep by Ryan Hartnett. He's in on the forecheck, throws the body around. Zuccarello is there as well, but now Marchand. Gets one to Frederick. Across the line, it is dropped. Weaving his way, trying through traffic, Marchand turns it over. Zuccarello springs Fiala. Zuccarello cutting. He gets it back. Oh, what a play by Pastrnak. Zuccarello backhands one from a hard angle, and Swayman steered that one aside, but a terrific back check dive by Pastrnak before Zuccarello could get the puck on his stick.
You said it. Tremendous effort. Laying out the timing of the dive by Pastrnak as well. Huge play to break up that two-on-one.
And that top line with Pastrnak, part of it out there for the moment, but now they will change with 6.5 minutes to go. Grizzlick outlets Craig Smith. Smith one-on-three. Pulls it right. Sends it around the wall. Dumba is there. Calmly is able to put it on the stick of Matt Boldy. And now Brodin will feather 1D. Foligno behind the net, hoping for Boldy. Instead, it's Taylor Hall. Pitches one up in between the benches, and Nico Sturm will send it back to regather to Brodin. Or rather, Kulikov. Dour to Sturm, right back to Dour on the far side. Dours to Candles. Freddie Gaudreau now in the right wing corner with 5:42 to go. Gaudreau tried to control behind the net. A stretch pass to Steen. He'll feather one deep. Nick Foligno in after it. Off the back of the net, it caroms to Hartman as he chops at it. Oscar Steen has it for the Bruins. Steen centers one, just missing was Coyle. Coyle has the puck on the goal line. He sets up Steen. Steen couldn't tee it up. He was tied up. Well defended by the Wild, and Dour able to send one in and peel off for a change.
Yeah, that's two misses for Coyle in this hockey game on the back door. One in the first period on a feed by Marchand, and then that one there with Oscar Steen. It's 3-2 Minnesota here late in the third. It could have been a lot worse if not for this terrific defensive play by David Pastrnak to break up the two-on-one. Terrific stuff by the Bruins forward to keep it a one-goal deficit.
Rookie laugh with his partner in crime there, Marco Rossi. Good start for him, and he's, you know, 11 forwards, going to get some ice time, get some time on the power play. Look at this play, heads up play, recognizing that there's a player there, Foligno, for a tip. And then, you know, every kid's dream, your hometown, this is a team you've rooted for growing up. You're playing against them in their building, but you get to score your first NHL goal in your first NHL game. He's played just under 12 minutes, and what a dream for him. I think all he wants right now is just to win this game with his team.
They've got the one-goal lead with under 5 minutes to go after the TV timeout. That gave Pastrnak, Bergeron, and Marchand a chance to rest. But here's Zuccarello with a take-back. Zuccarello, toe drag, and he could not tee it up. Bergeron with a stretch pass, looking for Pastrnak. And icing waved, or could have been at the last moment, granted to Minnesota, as Pastrnak, it looked like, was going to be the first player to get his stick on the puck. That's the case he's making, and I think Bruce Cassidy is equally perplexed.
Well, I think if the puck stays on the near side of the ice, Pastrnak would have negated the icing, but because the puck makes it to the other side of the ice, that's where Kulikov was closer to the puck. That's what the linesman deemed, and a defensive zone faceoff for Boston now.
You know, it's funny, I've had that conversation with many linesmen. It's they at the dots, they have to deem who would get the puck first, and actually because Kulikov got the puck first, I think he was proved right.
That's the ultimate evidence, isn't it?
Yeah, there you go. And you're right, it's because it wrapped around. If that puck stayed over there, certainly Pasta would have been there first.
And isn't it, if it gets to the dots and it's 50-50, the tie goes to the defense and you still grant icing if you're not 100% sure?
That is a question for Dave Jackson.
I'm not sure that a linesman would ever say it was 50-50.
Right, here's Hall between the circles. His shot partially blocked, it floats wide. Looking to center was Craig Smith, and instead it is brought forward by Marcus Foligno across the line. There's another shot from Matt Boldy, and Boldy is able to trap it. All right, Dave Jackson, we teed you up. That close icing with Pastrnak, what is the linesman's kind of Mendoza line when they try and figure out how to make that call?
Well, I think you guys nailed it. You're bang on. The linesman has to make a decision at the dots, has to decide who he thinks is going to get to the puck first. Because it was wrapped around, it's a judgment call. In that case, you're right. It was proven that the guy got there first, but it's a tough call. He has to make a judgment back at the dots, and that's the way it, you know, the way it goes sometimes.
50-50, who gets it?
It's always going to go to the D-man.
There you go. Right from the horse's mouth.
A broken stick slowed the puck up for Ben. Now Fiala to Zuccarello in the trapezoid. From his knees, was able to get it side of the net. That's chipped over the top by Hartman. Down to the last 3:25 to go in a one-goal game. Carlo winds one in around the wall. Goligoski comes together with Oscar Steen in the far corner. To a side they battle. Foligno tied up. Ben has the puck. And once again, Minnesota gets it out of harm's way.
Last few minutes, Minnesota's done an excellent job in the neutral zone and getting the puck in deep. It's going to be tough for Bruce Cassidy to get Swayman off the ice.
Nico Sturm ties his man up and wins the battle. Takes it away from Moore, leaves it in the corner for Dour. Dour back up to the point, Brodin. Right point now, Dumba. There's a drive. Karam's behind the net. Marchand first to it. Up to Bergeron. Marchand tries to win the race to the red line. But Dour sends it right back in. 2.5 minutes to go. Ahead of steam for Haula across the line. And he is interrupted in open ice by Marcus Foligno. Beautiful defensive play by Foligno.
And I think Haula trying to find a better opportunity and maybe with that speed, just rip that puck and look for a rebound. Had to get a little too cute. Foligno over the pick his pocket.
These three out here, Rossi and Boldy and Foligno, have seen a lot of ice in the last few minutes. It seems to be a trio that Evanston likes.
And look at Boldy, killing time behind the net, 1-on-3. And finally, the Bruins come away with the puck, under 2 minutes to go.
Yeah, Boldy's looked awfully comfortable in this game. And I'll tell you what, he wins battles. You can see the strength that he has on his feet. He's going to have a terrific NHL career. He does not look nervous one bit playing in his first NHL game.
Swayman moves the puck. When will he leave the crease? The Bruins have to get control of it and get it out of their end. Now they will. Marchand has it. Swayman looking over to the bench, waving the glove. The door is open, and there he goes. The extra attacker on. 6-on-5 for the Bruins, down by one. Bergeron. A shot that's easily handled and covered up by Kokkonen with 1:23 to go.
That's a smart play by Bergeron because now it allows his team to kind of regroup. If they want to call a timeout, they can. But instead of hanging on to the puck, just get it there and hope for a face-off and potentially get the timeout that you're looking for to draw up a play.
That was the first shot on net for the Bruins in 7 minutes. So well defended by Minnesota. Charlie Coyle's had some chances, though.
Yeah, he certainly has. I talked about it earlier. Couple of feeds on the back door. Coyle, the fantastic chance that he created on his own to get to good ice. Feed by Oscar Steen, not able to get that one off, a missed opportunity. And then he had one in the first period off a feed by Brad Marchand on the power play that he missed. So for Coyle, he's had some chances, not able to cash in. The hope is that maybe he can help cash in right now and get this game to overtime.
And AJ, this timeout looks like it's going to allow the Bruins to leave Marchand, Bergeron, and Pasternak out there.
Yeah, you know, give them some rest. You can see Bruce Cassidy's got the whiteboard out, and they've got to get inside. We talked about it before. That's what they've been trying to do. And in this break they had over Christmas, Bruce Cassidy talked about it being like a mini camp. He said, we did a lot of battle drills. We've got to get inside. We've got to own the net front. And right now, more than ever, minute 23 left. They've got exactly who they want out here. They've got the big guns out there. They've got everybody that can shoot and score goals. You mentioned Charlie Coyle. He's had the chances, and now's their time to do it.
Marchand, Bergeron, and Pasternak out. They've got 16 of the Bruins' 35 shots, but they turn it over here. The net is empty. Shot off the post by Hartman.
Good play.
Could
there
have ended it.
By Sturm, too, to feed it over. Good defense.
New life for the Bruins as Hall got it deep. But it's sent right back out to the red line. Coyle bats it out of midair. Pasternak has it. Brings it across the line, but a high sticking call, I believe, on the reach. Center circle was just called by the officials. It is touched with a high stick. So I would think that would probably force Jeremy Swayman back into the net. I don't know, 57 seconds. Would you put your goaltender back in with a center circle faceoff?
I wouldn't. I would trust that our centerman, well, he is going to go in, but I would trust that my centerman could win a faceoff. But seeing that if you don't win the draw, I guess it could be an empty netter. I would have taken the risk and kept him out for the extra attacker.
Well, Swayman is back in the net, and the Wild control the puck. And now he heads back to the bench. So the extra attacker jumps on as Taylor Hall joins the group. 6-on-5 for the Bruins. Coyle in the corner. Free by Bergeron. Coyle lost his stick. Pinching it is Pasternak. Tries to keep the puck in the offensive zone, but it's sent back in front of the penalty box doors, forcing Grizzlick to retreat behind his net.
Impressive poise right now for the Minnesota Wild.
30 seconds to go in the game. Hall forced it across. Pitched between the circles. Easily handled by Brodin. Got it to the far corner. Another broken stick for the Bruins. It's that time Hall's twig broke in half. The puck sent the length of the ice. 14 seconds to go in the game as icing is called on Minnesota. Alan important are these games for the Bruins? Well, Tampa Bay, Florida, Toronto, all playing extraordinarily well atop the Atlantic.
Yeah, and for Boston, they have games in hand. And, you know, I think that's something that they've been holding their hat on, and they started to win some of these games. And they're hoping that they can get one here and get this game to overtime. Important faceoff here for Bergeron.
Wins it to Marchand. The quick shot blocked. Pastrnak keeps it in. Marchand has it. 8 seconds to go. His wrister in traffic. Loose. A rebound. Put it on Kokkonen. He's looking for the puck. He covers it up. Just about every player on the ice ends up in the gathering in front of the Minnesota cage, but Kaapo Kokkonen, amidst all of that traffic, found the puck.
Absolutely impressive poise by Kokkonen here. You can see the battle in front of the net between Dumba and Coyle, and you can see Kokkonen just able to kind of hold his position, even though he's not really sure where the puck is at all times, making sure that he's sealing the low part of the ice. Really settled into this game. He's looked strong after giving up the first goal of the hockey game.
Bergeron again on the draw, a draw he must win with 4 seconds to go. And does. Marchand shot. Kokkonen makes the save with 1.7 seconds to go.
Another good save. I mean, off a faceoff, you got to be ready. You got to be on your toes. Prepare for the worst. And there was some traffic there. His own defender created that screen. But Kokkonen, recognizing not a lot of time left, get aggressive, get above the blue paint. Another solid save.
.7 seconds to go. Bergeron will try and pull it back to Marchand one last time, and does. Pastrnak's one-timer blocked. The rebound goes wide. Off the wall, last opportunity for Craig Smith. With players sprawling in the crease, the Minnesota Wilds survive and win a one-goal game here at TD Garden. On a night where the Boston College rookie makes a return home, and Matt Boldy scores a goal in his NHL debut.
A magical night for Matt Boldy. Grew up down the road in Millis, Massachusetts. Played at Boston College. Friends and family here. Scores the game-winning goal. A gutsy win for a depleted lineup for the Minnesota Wild here tonight.
That was a fun game, and the Wild survived. They win it 3-2 here in Boston. For Brian Boucher and A.J. Molesko, I'm Bob Beauchesne. Thanks for watching.